We were talking about the purpose of incarnation, and we have seen that incarnation, the first purpose was to reveal God to men, and the second, in fact, this is the most important thing, that is redemption of mankind. Without incarnation, it was not possible. And also, it's not just to save us and send us away, but God wants us to be His subjects, and He like to rule us, not like a tyrant or somebody who is tormenting us, no. But He is there to guide us, to rule us, to help us, like that. No, He is like a father. He's not like a person who want to make use of you, but He is like a father. A father in the family, He is ruling His children, but He is always looking for the benefits of the child, right? Likewise, we have a king, but He is not just a king, He is a father king. So the rule of the Lord is not to make us giving some kind of burden, but it is to help us, okay? And unless and otherwise we make people understand that He is Lord, the salvation is not complete. Even the message, many times we fail to introduce Jesus as the Lord. We say that He is the Savior. Of course, He is a Savior, but we should never ignore the truths, the real truth, that He is not just a Savior, He is our Lord. And incarnation is a pattern of Christian contact, how we need to live. And it is through the life of Jesus Christ we know how we need to live, or what is in God's mind for a Christian to live in this world. When we live in this world, God wants us to live like Jesus. And it is for this purpose we are predestined. We are predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. And also, incarnation is not just a purpose, but the incarnation itself gives us the provision. I told you that He is not just an agent of salvation, but He is the source of our salvation through the incarnation. Without the incarnation of Jesus Christ, it would have never been happening. He was not just diagnosing our disease, He was not even prescribing the medicine, but He was even providing what was needed for our salvation. So He diagnoses, He prescribes, and He provides. He is the means of our glory, and He is the author of our salvation. And it is to bestow His righteousness. We have seen that the life of Jesus is an example, or it's not just an example, He is the law. So the law says how we should live. And the life of Jesus was a law given to men to show them how they should live. So the life of Jesus is the law. But to fulfill that law, even Old Testament we had a law, but we did not have the ability to fulfill it. But here in the New Testament, we are given a law, not a lesser one, but a bigger one. Sometimes people say, oh, in the Old Testament there were many laws, but we thank God because there is no law in the New Testament. The New Testament law is something more than that. What is it? The life of Jesus. Old Testament, there is a written law, and if we fulfill it, it was okay. But here, even if you are fulfilling all the law that is written in the Bible, that will never happen. But we need to live like Jesus. And the life of Jesus is more than, He was fulfilling not just the law, but He was living a life more than the law. So now the law is Jesus Christ. And how do we live that life? We cannot live it with our own strength. What is needed is to allow Jesus to live in us. And if Jesus should start living in us, there should something happen even before that. What is it? We need to die. We need to die to ourselves. So Paul says, I'm crucified with Christ. And that is the basis for the life of Jesus Christ. I'm crucified with Christ. So no longer I, but Christ lives in me. So this is exactly what we need in these days. That's where He is not just a standard of life, but he is also the source of life. He is not just a standard of righteousness, but he is the source of righteousness. He is our righteousness, because it is not I who live, it is Jesus in my life. So we need to stop living for Jesus, rather we need to live, we need to allow Jesus to live in us. Seventh purpose, incarnation was necessary to make Jesus a compassionate high priest. So we know that Jesus is a compassionate high priest. What does it mean, a compassionate high priest? A high priest is a person who is a priest. There are three people standing in between God and man. There are three people. Who are they? A priest, a prophet, and a king. A priest, a prophet, and a king. All these three people are staying in between man and God. And who is a priest? A priest is a person who stands on behalf of man and plead to God. So a priest represents me before God. Everybody got it? You got it? A priest represents me. He is standing on behalf of me before God and pleading for me. That's a priest. And who is a prophet? Prophet is also standing between me and God. But there is a difference. The prophet doesn't represent man, the prophet represents God. So a prophet is a person who stands on behalf of God and plead to man. Who is a priest? He stands for us and plead to God. Who is a prophet? A prophet stands for God and plead to me. But both these people are standing in between God and me. And who is a king? A king is a person who fulfill or execute the designs or the law or the desire of God. He is also between God and man, but he is not pleading, he is executing things. He is executing things on behalf of God. Okay? Here, Jesus is a king, he is a priest, and he is a prophet. He stands on behalf of God and speaks to man, and he is executing things on behalf of God. At the same time, he is our high priest who stands on behalf of us and plead to God. So if somebody is standing on behalf of me, he need to understand me. If he doesn't understand me, then how can he represent me? You get my point? Everybody? Okay? So it was necessary for Jesus to come in flesh to understand my feelings, my struggles, my temptations, and everything. So Jesus took the form of a man and he lived among us. Not somebody away from people, but he lived among us. When he came here, he was not coming as the son of the emperor of Rome. He was not even coming as the son of Herod. He was coming as a child of a carpenter. And he was living in such situation. And the things that Jesus was undergoing, it is like what we have, all the situations that we are going through. He was sharing. In Hebrews chapter 2, it is clearly written all those kind of things. He was sharing everything, including the sufferings. It is said that God made Jesus perfect through his sufferings. Perfect means, don't think that Jesus was not perfect as a man. I mean, as God. He was God. But when he came to this world, God made him suffer so that God wanted to make him perfect as a man. And even he was dying, he knows everything, that all the situations. He knows what is shame. He knows what is embarrassment. He knows what is pain. He knows what is hunger. He knows every situation of mankind. So now he can plead to his Father on behalf of me. He is a compassionate person. He is a compassionate person because he understands me. He understands me. When I'm teaching young guys in Africa, I used to tell them that don't think that I came to this world. When I'm teaching the young ones, I teach about holiness and all, living holy in the university in Africa. You know, many times you cannot expect that kind of holy living because even the law doesn't, it's not a hindrance for many of the illegitimate acts like in the sexual life in Africa, many countries of Africa. You're free. It's a free country. So I tell them to live not their culture, but the biblical culture. I was asking them to live the biblical culture. Don't follow the culture of, I'm not against the culture of Africa or America or India, but if it contradicts with the biblical culture, which should we follow? It's the biblical culture. You understand? If my Indian culture contradicts with the biblical culture, I'm not supposed to follow the Indian culture. I'm supposed to follow what? The biblical culture. Many times, you know, in modern age, people think, oh, we are free. People are free and they do anything. Anything. I used to tell them to live or encourage them to live a holy life. And then I used to say, don't think that Saju has come to this world with gray mustache and all. Once I also was 17 years. I also was in the university. I also know the struggles that you are facing. Don't think that I'm directly came from heaven with gray mustache. No. I know the struggles of a young man. You understand what I say? Likewise, Jesus also was once 17 years old. Once he was 10 years old. Once he was 25 years old. So he understands the struggle of a 25-year-old boy. So he is compassionate. He cannot say, Lord, you do not know what kind of feelings I have in my mind. You do not know what kind of pain I am undergoing. He knows. He understands. He is a compassionate high priest. What made him compassionate? It is incarnation. If Jesus was not incarnated and if he was not living here in the earth as a man, that's the reason why he shared flesh and blood, because the sons were having flesh and blood. He also partook the same nature as Jesus was coming here. Don't think that he was falling from heaven all on a sudden and he was growing in a moment. Nothing like that. He came to this world as a small baby, an infant. And from that time onwards, he was living like you and me, going through all kind of struggles, shame. People were not believing him. Most of the time, people call him son of Mary, not son of Joseph. It has got a meaning. He was not considered as a legitimate child. Many times people were considering him as an illegitimate child. So all the shame, all the struggles he was undergoing, the pain, hunger, everything. He was feeding 5,000 people, but when he was hungry, he was not ready to perform a miracle for himself. Because he wanted to be a compassionate high priest for you and me. In everything. So the purpose of incarnation of Jesus, it was to understand his brethren. That's what in Hebrews chapter 2 we hear. And Hebrews chapter 4 verse 14 onwards. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we have not a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. He was tempted, but he was not yielding to the temptation. The first Adam was tempted and he was yielding to temptation. and he sinned. But Jesus, he was tempted, but he was not yielding to temptation. He knows what is temptation. The only difference, Adam was tempted not from inside, he was tempted from outside. Because when God created Adam, he was not corrupt. You understand? And it's the same with Jesus. Jesus never planned something. Sometimes you know what happens? We plan evil because we have evil inside. But Jesus was not planning any evil. All the temptations of Jesus were struggles from outside. Sometimes there is a question, maybe we will go through the temptations of Jesus Christ next. So we'll understand it more. So what I'm trying to say that Jesus also was tempted like you and me, yet without sin. What does it mean? That we also can resist temptation if you are allowing Jesus to live in you. So, a true Christian living, a holy living, is available for you. It's available for you. Some people think, oh, we can never live a holy life. Many times even pastors do not believe that they can live a victorious life. Many times we are not even preaching victorious Christian life. But what is the fact? If Jesus could live a spiritual life in this world, you also can. Only the thing that is needed is to allow Jesus to live in you. I'll explain it later. So incarnation made Jesus a sympathizer to you and me. He understands me because he also was going through the same thing that I'm undergoing. And incarnation, the eighth thing, the purpose, incarnation was necessary so that we can become the co-heirs of Jesus Christ. Co-heirs. We are sons. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9 to 11. I'll read it 9 to 11. But we see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting that he for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified have all one origin. That is why he is not ashamed to call them his brethren. You know, Jesus is God. He is my God. He is my father. He is my bridegroom. But he calls himself, he's my brother. Why? Because all the father has given him, all the inheritance Jesus has in heaven, I am a co-heir. You understand? I'm a co-heir. It is for me also. It is mine. Through Jesus, I am also becoming a child of God, and he is my elder brother, and I am his brother. He is not ashamed to be called his son's brethren. Ashamed to call them brethren. He called me a brother. And all the things that Jesus has in heaven, it belongs to me. It belongs to you. We are co-heirs with Jesus Christ. He is our elder brother. What a privilege God has given us. We have Jesus not as just as God, Lord, Savior. Also, we have an elder brother in heaven. That's Jesus Christ. So don't think that you are a stranger in heaven. If you are a brother of Jesus, then certainly you are a co-heir with him. And it is yours. Heaven is yours. Everything that is in heaven, it is yours. You have all the joy, all the glory. Especially it says about the glory of God. You understand? That's why it is written that For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory. So there we are sons, and at the same time he is our brother, elder brother. Bringing many sons to glory should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified have all one origin. Who is sanctifying us? It is Jesus Christ. Who are sanctified? It is us. So the person who is sanctifying is Jesus Christ. The people who are sanctified, it is we. But we all have one origin, that is God the Father. So we are brethren. It's very interesting. It's very interesting. So we have Jesus in heaven, and it is not only that, a glory is awaiting for us. The glory that God has given to Jesus, it awaits for us. We are co-heirs with the glory. Don't think that we are fortunate to have gold and silver and things like that in heaven. Even if you have gold and silver, what are you going to do with that in heaven? Do you think that you can put it in bank and get some money and do something? No. See, I'm not saying that there is no heaven, there is no gold in heaven, there is no throne, nothing like that. I'm not saying that. But even if it is there, you don't consider it as valuable in heaven. Because the most valuable thing in heaven is the slain lamb. When you see your bridegroom, Jesus, then you will never think about the thrones and the crowns and the things that you get in heaven. I don't think... no problem. Don't worry. So don't worry. It's like that. When it is for a long time, it happens like that. Okay, come back. Don't look at there all the time. Hey, what's happening? Don't worry. Okay, are you here? Even if it burns, don't worry, we go to heaven, right? Why you worry about that? We have only one thing in our mind, that's heaven. And in heaven, what do we have? We say we have gold and silver and things like that. I don't care, even if there is no gold in heaven. But gold doesn't make any sense for me, even in this world. If gold is nothing to me in this world, then what is it for me in the coming world? And if you are seeing heaven and everything only in terms of gold, you are still material. You are still a materialist, right? You just need material things. You are looking after material things. And that's the reason why you are always, oh, there is gold in heaven, there is silver in heaven, there are thrones in heaven, those crowns are in heaven. Why can't you say that I have my bridegroom Jesus in heaven? You understand? That's what is needed. So when you start loving Jesus, you never love anything else. Everything is there. It doesn't make sense for you. Because you are not after the thrones and the crowns, but you are after Jesus Christ. Why you want to go to heaven? Is it because of gold? I'm not looking for gold in heaven. I just want to go to heaven because I have Jesus there. There's a Sufi poem that says, it's a prayer. The Sufi poet, in fact, he's not a Christian, but still he sings like this. Lord, why I am following you? Is it because of the fear of hell that I follow you? If I am following you because of the fear of hell, put me in that hellfire. If it is because of the riches in heaven that I follow you, close the doors of heaven before me. But Lord, if it is for you and you alone that I follow you, put me close to your heart. If it is the riches of heaven that makes me follow you, close the doors before me. Close the doors of heaven before me. If it is the fear of hell that made me follow you, then put me in that hellfire. But if it is you alone, So that should be our attitude. That is the relationship. So we all need to have that kind of relationship. Only one thing that should make us delight, it is Jesus. That is true Christian life. That is true Christian life. So Jesus is our elder brother, and what awaits for us in heaven? It is Jesus and the glory, because he is leading many sons to glory, right? He is leading many sons to glory, and he called himself as a brother. Romans chapter 8 verse 29 chapter 8 verse 29 we see, for those whom he foreknew he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that we might be he might be the firstborn among many brethren. There also we see that Jesus is a brother for all those who are going to heaven. We are predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that we might be the firstborn, he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Because in heaven, when we reach there, we need to see that we are confirming to the, we have already confirmed to the image of his son. Going to heaven, before we reach heaven, we need to make sure that we have reached the shape of Jesus Christ. Even in 1 John chapter 3, we see that God has bestowed a big, great love so that we may be called as the children of God. And we are children of God now, but we do not know what we would become. In my website, I have explained all these things in a message. In my website, you can go through a lot of messages in that website. It is very simple. It is sjmathew.com. Because you know that I am Saju John Mathew. It's very simple. sjmathew, M-A-T-H-E-W, only one T, .com. So you can have a lot of messages there. Okay.